Daughters of the King will meet on November 6th at Panera Bread on 41st Street. We will be having baptisms on November 6th, which is All Saints Sunday, an exciting day to be in the church. If you or anyone you know would like a baptism, feel free to contact myself, Mother Cheryl, or anyone here at the church, the front desk. So we'd like to get you on that list so we can do that. Our annual Halloween boobash will happen on October 23rd from 5 to 7. It is a wonderful time to come together as a community. We will be serving kids from Trinity, New Hope, and Emerson Elementary. Come and join us. You can also donate money or candy to this, or also come and provide a trunk so we can have the kids come around and trick or treat with us. Wherever you are in your spiritual journey, Trinity welcomes you. Good morning, Trinity. So glad that you are with us. If you're new with us this morning, so glad that you're here. We will continue our bulletin. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of Thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love Thee and worthily magnify Thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in Christ has revealed thy glory among the nations, preserve the works of thy mercy, that thy church throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of thy name, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The same night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please, tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from Paul's second letter to Timothy. As for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you learnt it, and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I solemnly urge you, proclaim the message, be persistent whether the time is favorable or unfavorable, convince, rebuke, and encourage with the utmost patience in teaching. For the time is coming when people will not put up with sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own desires, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander away to myths. As for you, always be sober, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, carry out your ministry fully. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory be to you, Lord.
Jesus told the disciples a parable about their need to pray always and not to lose heart. He said, "In a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor had respect for people. In that city there was a widow who kept coming to him and saying, 'Grant me justice against my opponent.' For a while he refused, but later he said to himself, 'Though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice, so that she may not wear me out by continually coming.' And the Lord said, 'Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth?" The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Wrestling with God or with one of God's messengers doesn't sound like the kind of bout you could win, right? But I think we do it all the time. Surrendering the notion that we might know better than God is not one of our strongest suits. Our own wants and desires seldom take a backseat to anyone else's ideas. So why should God be any different? We are generally good listeners on Sunday mornings, but once outside the church doors, our own perspectives about life's situations, how we treat others, and whether or not we're right about things, those really dominate our existence. And I'm including myself in that as well. Jesus says, "Love your neighbor as yourself, and give generously to the poor, and don't judge." Yeah, we say. But when Jesus says to love others, he probably never met Jeff. Jeff's a bonehead. Surely I'm off the hook with that one. Apologies to anybody coincidentally who's named Jeff. And what about the poor who seem to be working the system with their food stamps and unemployment checks and donated clothes? They're scraping by without my help. Plus, how would I afford a car purchase or my vacation or my chance to visit that new restaurant if I throw my hard-earned dollars in that direction? And please, please, not judging. You're talking about my hobby. Did you see those shoes she was wearing? Don't you just hate the way he laughs? Can you believe they're serving that kind of coffee? What an idiot voting for that candidate. We wrestle with God a lot. But I maintain that we don't realize it because it's usually pretty subtle. And also, surprise, God lets us win. It grieves the Almighty, but the price of our freedom of choice leaves us frequently at odds with the directions we really should go. God loves us so much that there are no strings attached. We aren't marionettes. We choose our own paths, but that doesn't make us right. The lesson this morning from 2 Timothy tells us that having itching ears, they, meaning all of us, will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own likings and will turn away from listening to the truth. That is us in a nutshell. Ouch. Our need for things like power and money and fame and respect and being loved so completely supersede our clear thinking and create blind spots for us when it comes to seeing the rest of the world as it really is. When we are yearning for power and influence, God is hoping our attention will turn to a life of service. When we are focused on securing more money, our Savior is wishing we would share more of what we already have. When our daydreams are about fame and popularity, the hosts of heaven dream of a time when we might be inclined to honor someone else whose efforts haven't been properly noticed. When we aim for a higher level of respect and standing, the Lord aims for us to lift up a person whose life has been shattered. And when we long for unconditional love to be showered upon us, Jesus aches for us to hold the hand of a troubled child, or call a friend who is lonely, or to hug the shoulders of a person who's lost. Generally speaking, we live lives of obsession. our comforts, our joys, and our belongings. But my friends, if you haven't noticed, this life is so short, and so much of what we obsess over and fear and worry about is not really very important. Several times in my life, when I've been burdened with lots of troubles, it's been helpful to get up in the mountains or high above it all on a plane flight where I can look down and gain a new perspective, a different perspective, realizing how little I really am and how insignificant my problems really are. A solid and clear viewpoint is often hard to come by and sometimes hard to accept or swallow, even when we know it's true. A good friend of mine who used to be my priest years ago likes to put it this way. 100 years from now, none of us will still be here, and many of our personal contributions and attributes will be long forgotten. But I want to leave this earth knowing that I made a true difference, assured that other lives were better because I was around, aware that I'd enjoyed and been enjoyed. That's what life is truly about. It's not about who has the most stuff. It's not about who's right and who's wrong. It's not about who can pile their plate the highest at the dinner table. It's not about change for the sake of change, nor is it about always keeping things the same. It's not about who has the most impressive address. And I've got to tell you, a number of years ago, there was a woman from Trinity who was both shocked and a bit appalled that my zip code was the same as hers. There goes the neighborhood, right? It's not about those things. It's about love and compassion and warmth and cooperation and generosity. These are the intended hallmarks of our existence. And in the words of Psalm 121 and our passage from the Gospel of Luke this morning, we are armed with everything we need to keep the boat afloat. We hear phrases like, "I lift up my eyes to the hills." Continue in what you have learned. Always pray. Do not lose heart. He will keep your life. Folks, our lives are truly spectacular. We are blessed with family, friends, neighbors, and clergy. Our cups runneth over. And all we have to do is let some of that goodness spill out to those around us so that other lives can be as good as ours. As the song says, they will know we are Christians by our love. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. With the power of the Holy Spirit, from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, and Polson, our own bishop, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. Lord, in your mercy. And to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. Lord, in your mercy. We beseech thee also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land. For Joseph, our president, Kevin, our governor, and GT, our mayor, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Lord, in your mercy. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. Lord, in your mercy. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor Barbara, Vivienne, Jackie, Siren, Leslie, Lynn, David, Paulie, Belinda, Becky, Melanie, Jack, Ben, Finley, Joe, Wyatt, Nancy, Lisa, Susan, Neo, Philippe, PK, Kirsten, Cabo, Judy, Neil, Paul, Donnie, and victims of violence and all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Lord, in your mercy. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against thee in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved thee with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in thy will and walk in thy ways to the glory of thy name. Amen.
Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with heart of repentance and true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand as you are able. My friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Again, good morning. Have a seat for just a few moments. All right. Anyone here at Trinity for the first time? I'm going to come around this way. See, you thought you were going to get away with it without people actually recognizing that you were new, you know? Welcome. Glad that you are here. Anyone else here for the new for the first time? I'm coming that way. So glad you're with us. Welcome to Trinity. Glad you're here. I thought she'd been here before. All right, so we've got choral evensong tonight at 5 o'clock with a reception to follow. So please make sure you can join us for that. Daughters of the King will meet for a meeting on October 22nd at Panera Bread on 41st Street. We are doing baptisms on November 6th, All Saints Sunday. And to date, we have 6 baptisms ready for here. So some at 9 o'clock, some at 11. So if it is your wish to be baptized or you know someone who needs to be baptized, make sure you let one of us know, front desk or myself, Mother Cheryl, anyone, Bert, anyone, let us know that because we would love to have that time. Again, 6 baptisms? Wow. Okay, so going to be a busy day. Our Halloween Boo Bash is coming up next week from 5 to 7. We are in need of donations of big bags of candy or money for the big bags of candy. So we would love for you to participate in us. We're going to have kids coming through from Trinity, from New Hope and Emerson Elementary. So come and join us for that. I already have my outfit ready to go for that, and it's going to be a little different this year. I'm going as a Jedi this year, I think. I actually have a dueling lightsaber, so anybody wants to duel me, bring it on. Would love that. Also, we continue to do our pledge drive, so if you haven't gotten your pledge card in, please make sure that you get that in so we can begin to form the budget. And Scott Acock is our stewardship speaker this morning.
Good morning. This is my third service today. I tell you, I think I've got all the bases covered today, at least. Elizabeth Barrett Browning said, "How do I love you? Let me count the ways." And I'm supposed to tell you how I love Trinity, but I'm not going to tell you all the ways I love Trinity because it would take a lot of time. But I'm going to point out a couple of things that have brought me here. And I think when I first came to Trinity, I only knew a handful of dear friends that were here and didn't really know anybody. So the first thing that caught me with Trinity was I want you to actually look up at these windows, these beautiful stained glass. That's this architecture everything about Trinity when I came in here called me to look up. The music soars at Trinity, the choir, and all of that was important to me, someone who has struggled most of my life, off and on, with a mood disorder. Looking up is important. It brings us the beauty, and the music was hopeful. And so that was the first impression, really, had to do with this structure. And I don't think that's enough. I think you have to have more than that, and we do have more than that at Trinity, but it was a start. The other part is I have to give you some background. I was raised Southern Baptist in the Delta of Northeast Arkansas, or we call it the Flatlands. Some people call it the Sunken Lands. But that part of the country, we were Southern Baptists. I'm not going to disparage the Baptist church, because I've been to some wonderful Baptist services and great sermons and great people. And there were great people in our church. But I didn't hear a lot of sermons on the love of God. I heard a lot of sermons about hellfire and brimstone. It was that type of church. And so growing up, I never quite felt good enough in that church. And so my spiritual journey has always been one of moving towards a bigger God, a God that was more inclusive. And so the next step in that journey was I got caught up in the 70s in the Jesus movement. How many of you remember the Jesus movement? Yeah, and I got caught up in that, and it was wonderful, and I got involved with some non-denominational charismatic churches, and I was a young hippie wannabe, and that was kind of, they were saying, we don't care if you have long hair, we don't care if you have tie-dye t-shirts, you can come to church barefoot, and none of that matters, and that appealed to me. And I'm not going to come to Trinity barefoot, but back then that was something for me, and that was back when I actually had hair, and so I ended up getting very much involved in all of that, and again, I want to say from all of that spiritual journey, lots of good things came out of that. I don't regret any of it. And I gained a lot from all of those journeys. But it still seemed to be that there was something eventually, even in that where that started creeping back in, that not good enough. And, you know, you can take the boy out of the Baptist church, but you can't take the Baptist out of the boy altogether. And so a friend at college, a friend on my floor suggested I try the Episcopal Church, and so I did, and went to St. John initially, and that was, I fell in love with the liturgy, the ritual, all of it spoke to me, the connection to the past, and how rooted it was, and grounded, and so I went from there to St. Aidan's Episcopal Church, and then from St. Aidan's here to Trinity. That journey all along has been one of moving towards a bigger God, one that's more inclusive, one that where I am good enough. But I have to tell you one more story. I remember when I was at St. Aidan's, my professor and dear friend Bill Epperson, who was a member at Trinity and is no longer here with us, he noticed that sometimes at St. Aidan's, I would cross my arms when I went up for Eucharist, and maybe I was doing it more frequent than he had noticed other people doing it. And he asked me one time about it, and I said, well, I cross my arms because I'm not worthy to receive this week, because I feel like I'm not living a good enough life, I'm sinning too much, or Well, and he laughed and put his hand on my shoulder. I think he said, oh, you silly boy. And, you know, he said, it's not about you being good enough. It's about God. And God is good enough. And because God is good enough and because God is so big, then you're good enough. And that really struck me and stayed with me. I never crossed my arms again going up to receive communion because the point being made to me was I'm going forward, but really it's God coming to meet me. And that's enough. And I'm not going to say that Trinity is a perfect church. There are no perfect churches. We're just big dysfunctional families. And this is like my big old Southern dysfunctional family who I love but don't necessarily always like everybody. But we get together over the holidays. We share a meal. And we put those differences aside because there's something bigger. We do that every Sunday at Trinity. We come together and we're from all walks of life, all persuasions, all ethnicities. We've got different political beliefs, but we come forward, we go to the altar, and we break bread together. And whether you like me or don't like me, that gets, or I like you or don't like you, it doesn't matter in that moment because God is bigger. God is good enough. You are good enough. I am good enough. And that's why I'm at Trinity. Thank you.
Scott, thank you for sharing your story. And Bert, thank you for your sermon today and reminding us who we are and whose we are in the process. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
I will remind you that all persons are welcome to receive at this altar. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, Creator of light and source of life, who has made us in thine image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we, Lord, and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, be to thee, O Lord, our God, for that thou didst create heaven and earth, and didst make us in thine own image, and of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there a full and perfect sacrifice for the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue, a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice, until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to thee, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, we, thy people, do celebrate and make with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again with power and great glory. And we humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and with thy word and Holy Spirit to bless and sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be unto us the body and blood of thy dearly beloved Son, Jesus Christ. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, whereby we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies. Grant, we beseech thee, that all who partake of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and also that we and thy whole church may be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom,
in the unity of the Holy Ghost. All honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
saying the post-communion prayer together, let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech thee, O heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.